You're listening to the Final Draft Insider View, a podcast where we talk to screenwriters and storytellers about all the stories they tell. Today, we have on Taika Waititi. You might know his name from things like Boy, What We Do in the Shadows, Flight of the Conchords. But today, we're going to talk a little bit about The Hunt for the Wilderpeople. Taika, thank you so much for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
It seems like you've had a career that has gone really, really well, but I'm gathering from some of your bio and your backstory, if you would catch the folks who are listening up, it doesn't sound like this was exactly what you planned on doing. I mean, what was the beginning of your storytelling career like?
I started off as a painter and a visual artist. So all I really wanted to do was illustrate and draw and I guess, you know, storytelling as well. It's just that I mainly focused on, just on visual mediums that weren't moving. And eventually, throughout my teens and stuff, I did a lot of acting and, you know, was in a lot of theatre and all through my 20s as well. And so doing that, I was often writing. That's sort of where my writing started, was in the theatre. So I was often making up stuff with my friends, and we would collaborate on various things, and we would we would basically write our own plays and put each other in them and direct each other. And because back then, like, there wasn't really a huge comedy scene in New Zealand, and we kind of had to make it ourselves, so that's really the start of it. And then eventually, when I was in my late 20s, I decided to explore film, just because it was something I hadn't done yet, and made a couple of short films and realized that I quite liked that art form, so stuck with it, and I've been doing it ever since.
That's great. Well, what were some of the things you learned about writing, about storytelling, when you were doing those early sketches, early plays? What did you pick up there? What was important?
I think there were two things, really. The first one was that the audience is the most important thing. If you're doing live storytelling, you need to, you know, I think it's very important for people to experience that at some point in their lives, trying to keep an audience interested in what you're doing and trying to and learning to understand that relationship between the performer or between the storyteller and the audience, and how do you keep them interested? How do you keep them feeling like they're part of the story and relating to the characters and stuff, and that's something that I think is invaluable to a storyteller, and also something that you can often only get through interacting with an audience. I think filmmakers often are very, especially young filmmakers, are very disconnected from audiences if they've never experienced theatre before, and so they often, you know, that's where you'll find people often very they're into their own idea, and they're of the opinion that if an audience doesn't get the story, then the audience is dumb, or they put their vision before the audience's enjoyment of the film, look, that's fine for some artists, I think, but I think just from my background, I really I've just learned to respect an audience and to understand that, sometimes you just have to, you have to fashion your story in a way which is going to keep them satisfied.
Yeah, I feel like when you're doing live performance comedy, especially, you really get live feedback from the audience as to whether or not they're being entertained. And
that's, it's a big part of my writing and whether I edit film is trying to keep the pace up, trying to keep things moving and earning those pauses, or earning, the kind of the long, awkward scenes and the things where you have the moments where the dialogue goes on too long, but understanding that you've also got to keep things moving along.
Right.
A lot of that came from those early days of learning when an audience is getting bored.
Sure, absolutely. I think one of the things that no one gets bored with are your characters. I was looking at What We Do in the Shadows and, of course, Hunt for the Wilderpeople. And I think both of those just have characters that I feel like you're never going to confuse those people with anyone else. And how do you start to do that? How do you, when you start writing, how do you get to those people and how do you find them?
Well, I find that a lot of the time my stories, if you look at what they're really about, they're not really about much. Nothing really happens. And so I feel like I need to put really interesting characters in them, in these stories to keep people interested and to keep them kind of hooked into the very simple story that's taking place. So a lot of the characters that I write are a lot of time they're based on people that I've met or people I've seen, and it's usually like I never really start out with what a character looks like. I think that comes later for me. I start off with dialogue and a kind of and personality. I guess I start with personality and try and find ways of putting these different characters together, different personalities together, and seeing what happens. And so a lot of dialogue I write just kind of comes out with no real intention of what, you know, for the scene. No, you know, I don't feel like, oh, I've got to get to this point and get this information out, and then we're in the scene. I just write big, long
mm-hmm.
conversations between people and just see what happens. And then eventually, you know, when you can get in the heads of, you know, many different characters, and a lot of that I feel comes from my background as an actor, and also just as someone who's observed people throughout their life. And, you know, I'm very good at retaining information and character types and watching people and thinking, oh, what a fascinating person, how they interact with my mother. And, you know, kind of just store these little ideas and these little nuggets away in my head. And I never really write things down. And I always feel like the good ideas will rise to the surface, you know, the good ideas will present themselves to you at some point when you're writing. And I do that. It's where my characters come from. I don't purposefully try and make them say weird things or, you know, make them super quirky or anything. I think a lot of that comes later, and a lot of it happens actually while I'm shooting, you know.
Sure.
For a character while we're shooting, and just say, okay, your character's obsessed with the Terminator movies, and so I'm just going to feed you lines about that. And so a lot of writing for me happens while I'm shooting as well.
Okay. One of the characters I was thinking about was Viago, who you play in What We Do in the Shadows. And I think he's someone that I'd be curious to see where he comes from and how. What was the origin of that character? Where were those personalities ripped from?
That character was sort of, well, because we needed for the dynamic in the house, in the vampire household. You know, we all kind of had ideas for what kind of characters needed to be there, and you know, there was going to be the one who was really old and kind of going senile, and he was crazy, and then there was the young, sort of teenage vampire who, you know, was really reckless and always left the curtains open. Just before dawn and stuff, and then there's all and because, you know, there was, you know, vampires and people who play vampires always wanted to, you know, it's a great opportunity to play someone crazy and someone, you know, like a pervert, you know, who likes to feed on virginal blood. But we also had to have a character that kind of grounded everyone and was a bit like the mum in the flat, you know, someone who, and there's always that kind of person. Yeah, so like Jermaine and I really based a lot of the character dynamics of that film on flats that we had lived in, sometimes together and sometimes in different other flats, and just, you know, based on people that we'd shared flats with. And there's always, I think, you know, whoever you go flatting with, there's always someone who is the one who tidies up and he's always kind of wants to be paid on time, and there's always the guy who's the, you know, the person who makes a job roster, a chore roster, and you know, so there's that person who's like does the admin. I really wanted to play someone like that because I'm not massively like that in real life. I wanted to play someone who was just sort of trying to keep things all together and just wanted everything to be just so. And I think that's really good for also for the film. Like, you needed someone to kind of hold your hand and guide you
through the world, because all the characters in that film are so insane. It's really hard to for an audience to feel safe with one of those characters. And, you know, Viago's, he's the most down to earth of all of them, and he's kind of the doorway into that world. And also, the and in terms of like how I played that character, we kind of joke that it's a mixture of C-3PO and my mother.
All right, I see that. I absolutely see that now. So let's talk a little bit about Hunt for the Wilderpeople.
It's based on a book. So I adapted a quite a well-known New Zealand novel mm-hmm. called Wild Pork and Watercress. And it's, and it's a quite loved, beloved book in New Zealand. And the film is very different to the book. The book is not massively funny. It's doesn't have a lot of the character, doesn't have the social welfare character, doesn't have characters and stuff like that, and it's a bit less of an adventure. So I started adapting that a few years ago. I actually wrote the first draft of that in 2005, I think, and then went off and made three other movies.
Wow.
And came back to that script in 2014, so almost 9 years later. And oh no, 2015 we shot. Yeah, so 2014. And so yeah, and then we shot in 2015. And I think by then, you know, my style had changed a lot. And yeah, the first draft was not a comedy. The first draft of the script was, I wouldn't say it's a big drama, but it was, it was just a bit more of a kind of a tense adventure. You know, like, you know, these guys on the run, and it was more about survival than, you know, about Ricky's quest to find a family. And so I think when I came back to it, it was, just my ideas about how this kind of film could be presented had changed, and I felt like it should just be more of an adventure and something that, you know, multiple generations could see and enjoy together, which is something you don't really get much of these days. It's a film where, you know, little kids and the grandparents and the people in between can go and enjoy a film together. And that was one of the focuses with making Wilderpeople, was to try and make something that, you know, an entire family could enjoy. So I started writing it again. I rewrote the entire thing in 2014, and we shot in 2015.
What kind of stuff, when you started shooting, what kind of stuff changed along the way there?
I'd come up with more character ideas for people and visual gags and stuff. I'd come up with a lot more sort of like character nuances and visual gags. And you know, when prepping a film, I'm always try and get to see the locations early, so I know, okay, well, we could have a great visual gag here because this room is such an interesting shape. Or and I always start thinking about maybe how the blocking will happen and what the characters might be doing and things like that. And then props as well. I like to think a lot about props and what they, you know, and because a lot of like what I sort of put in my films is I do definitely use like a lot of visual gags, but that sort of stuff happens around. All that stuff really starts being strengthened when I'm shooting. In the writing phase, there might be one or two things that I'm thinking about, but I have no real idea at that stage of what things will look like. I just sort of say, you know, two characters in a field, two characters next to a tree, two characters, you know, and that's sort of as deep as I get into my things of like what, you know, what the environment is. Mm-hmm. You know, two characters in a spaceship. I don't know what a spaceship looks like. So I wait till, you know, a lot of that happens on set, and a lot of improvisation happens on set as well. So a lot of the time the dialogue is more of just a guide for me.
That's great.
So Jermaine and I wrote an entire script for Shadows, and I think it was like 150 pages or something, and we never ended up using it.
Wow.
We had it ourselves, and we would know what the scenes were, and we, you know, kept a close eye on the script, knowing that, you know, we needed, that was a guide for us, and so we would know exactly what was supposed to happen in the scene and what we wanted from the scene, but we just never showed it to any of the actors. So they would turn up and we'd just say, okay, so in the scene we just need you to, you know, to try and convince this this victim to eat this spaghetti or whatever, you know, so like a lot of that. And then and a lot of the times, interestingly, like, it, you know, it turned out pretty much exactly like the script. And other times it was and other times it would be so way off and so weird, but also like a lot better than what we had written.
Wow. Okay. Well, look, I know we don't have a whole lot of time, but I'd love to talk to you as briefly as we can about your upcoming projects, because it seems like there are so many. I mean, you've got follow-ups to What We Do in the Shadows, and you're directing Thor Ragnarok at the same time. What are you working on right now? What are you doing with it?
At the moment, I'm editing. Okay. So yeah. So right now, I'm in the middle of just cutting this thing together, and we had a huge shoot down in Australia. I've been editing for about a month now, and it's going well. I'm really, it's obviously too long right now, but how it's progressing. I'm always very relaxed about this kind of thing, because I know just from doing a few films now, I just know that everything will turn out okay.
Wow. I mean, you seem very relaxed. It seems like it would be a lot of pressure on something as big as a Marvel movie.
Yeah, but I feel like there's even less pressure for me on this. So many people working on it.
That, wow.
You know, that it's like, on my ones, it's basically just me and, you know, some other people. But it's usually me doing everything.
Mm-hmm.
This one, there's like a lot more support. And, this film, everyone wants to keep working on it until it's perfect. And
that's amazing.
Yeah, so it's good.
That's great. And then what about the follow-ups to What We Do in the Shadows that I know, I mean, are they just kind of sitting there and waiting for you to become more available, or what's happening with that?
Yeah, they are. There's some TV adaptations which are going to happen without me.
Oh, okay.
Well, basically the writing is happening without me.
Okay.
I'm just going to work. But, so those things are going ahead. The actual film sequel spin-off thing will one day happen. The film sequel thing will happen. It's just that both Jermaine and I are so busy with all our different separate lives. It's very hard for us to get together and actually write something. Plus, we're incredibly lazy. that you'll learn if you ever get to work with me is I'm a hard worker, but I really don't like doing stuff.
I completely understand. Yeah, of course. It sounds like you would just be incredibly swamped at this point in your career.
Yeah, but you know, shit, I'm really lucky. It's, you know, I feel good and grateful.
That's great. Well, as a grateful guy, looking back at the start of trying to invent your own comedy scene in New Zealand to where you are now, what's the one piece of advice you could leave for our listeners out there? What ought they to be thinking about in their careers?
If I ever give advice about half a day later, I was like, oh, no, I shouldn't have said that. People. I don't know, I feel like for us, when we were trying to do our style of jokes and our style of comedy, and like just basically like, I guess the New Zealand style of comedy is like what we do anyway.
Mm-hmm.
Just basically just laughing at the most boring shit in the world. And it's like there's an art to making boring comedy, like comedy about boring things. So that's sort of what we do. But when we started out, no one could understand what we were trying to do. And everyone was so, you know, everyone wanted to do super mainstream, really stupid, broad comedy stuff, and which we hated and still hate. And it's just, I think, there was a pressure to just follow that trend and just do kind of a really broad, mind-numbing style of comedy. That, but we just couldn't do it, and so we kind of stuck with our style. And you know, when Brett and Jermaine did Concords, you know, no one, it was such a different style for America and for a lot, you know, for a lot of people around the world. Yeah. And that comes from, I think, you know, eventually if you stick with something that you believe in, there will be an audience for it. You know, like I'd rather, like I've always, you know, I've had like a slow build up of I wouldn't say followers, but people who like follow my work and, you know, and appreciate it and like my style of storytelling and comedy. And I'm glad that I did that and didn't just leap in and start trying to make a studio film right at the beginning.
Sure.
Because, you know, my style wouldn't have developed and I wouldn't be the filmmaker I am today. I might be rich, but I definitely wouldn't be telling interesting stories.
Sure.
I think my films would be terrible.
That's great. That's a great piece of advice.
Okay. I don't know if there was any advice in there that was talking about me.
Definitely. Oh, there's some insight in that for sure.
Some insight that someone can glean.
Yeah. Yes, absolutely. Well, Taika Waititi, thank you so much. You can check out Hunt for the Wilderpeople now. I grabbed it on iTunes myself this week, and it was fantastic. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you so much for having me.
If you're out there listening, please let us know if you like the podcast by leaving us a rating or a review on iTunes, and you can follow us, Final Draft Inc., on Twitter, @Final Draft Inc. Thanks so much, and see you next time.